Let me take you back in time to the year 1981, when translation studies as a discipline in and for itself was still in its infancy. I myself was turning 40 then, with one book in Hebrew and a small English collection of articles to my name. As time went by, it became more and more clear to me that inasmuch as the study of translation and translating was to develop as a more than a mere sidekick of other fields of study, it would have to have an international journal of its own. I immediately put together a 7-page document on the study of translation. What did I do here? I have a sentence twice here. Immediately put together a 7-page ideological platform for such a journal, which I submitted to the young German publishing house, Gunther Narr, whose book list, mostly in linguistics, already included a small number of titles on translation. The truth of the matter is, this was the only non-Israeli publisher I happened to have met before, having spent my sabbatical in Germany. Surprisingly enough, Mr. Narr expressed great interest in the document. In fact, to my inexperienced eyes, he looked almost enthusiastic to embrace it. Unfortunately, a few months later, the Narr, pun most definitely intended, the Narr retracted his decision, fearing that a journal solely devoted to translation, even though conceived of in rather broad terms, a journal devoted to translation only, would not sustain a large enough audience, probably. Audience, yes. I took his word for it as if I had any other choice. I kept the frustrating experience to myself for a number of years, and then I told a good friend of mine, José Lambert, about it. His suggestion was that I come to Leuven and present the project to the local academic publishing firm, Peters, whose list contained mainly books in theology, philosophy, ethics, classical studies, archaeology, history of art, medieval studies, oriental studies, linguistics, and literature, copied from their internet site. José promised to prepare the grounds for our meeting, which did in fact take place in 1987, if I'm not mistaken. The two of us even felt that we were making real progress. However, a few hours later, José came running to me, saying that he had just had a telephone call from Mrs. Claire Benjamins in Amsterdam, expressing interest in adopting the unborn baby and asking us to at least suspend our negotiations with Peters and listen to what she had to offer. To be sure, to this very day, I have no idea as to how Claire came to hear about us and why she decided to adopt us. Be that as it may, preparations started very soon, and in the middle of 1989, the first issue of Target finally saw the light of day. From that time on, 20 volumes were published, more or less regularly, more or less. Altogether, 40 issues with over 7,200 pages of articles, papers, and reviews. 20 years in the life of periodical is ample time for an interim stock-taking, especially as it goes together with a major change of editorship. Also, time seems ripe for some patting on the proverbial back, which I dare say Target has earned. Maybe I'm not the one to do it, but there's nobody else. What I would like to do today is present a number of half-baked observations of a sociocultural nature. One assumption of mine is that academic periodicals, which make a difference, do not simply document what goes on in the discipline, which they certainly do. They also direct it, whether concretely by putting forward topics for research and discussion and setting an agenda, or more abstractly by influencing the general scholarly atmosphere. The opening sentences of my presentation may well have sounded as a piece of memoirs. However, there is full justification to take them as an indication of some features which would have important implications for Target, first and foremost in terms of the relationships between the selection of the publisher, be it selecting or being selected by one, and the nature of the periodical. Thus, as I said, first approach was a medium-sized, quite young, but already somewhat established publisher in continental Europe, in one of the very small few countries where translation had been taken seriously and dealt with rather excessively. Remember that I'm talking about 1981. By contrast, the possibility of approaching a British, let alone an American publisher, old or new, was never so much as toyed with. The reaction in the 80s would probably have been, translation what? The fact that this stance has been changing in the last two decades may be at least in part accorded to Target, I think. Rather, we stayed in the continent, which did enhance the European twist translation studies has had anyway. We then tried our luck with a small Belgian publisher who did have a record of 130 years in the profession and a considerable amount of prestige in international academic circles, but was still rather local in nature. We finally established long-term and very good working relations with a publishing house of an in-between status, which then grew and attained prestige together with Target and the book series, which was added a few years later, and at least partly due to these two. By the way, a book series had formed an integral part of the original document. The finding of publisher engendered at least one important factor which directed and limited our editorial work ever since. For reasons which had to do with the distribution of the periodical, of what the distribution of the periodical was thought or wished to be, the Benjamin's people insisted that most of the articles be written in English, with an odd paper in French and or German. No other languages were allowed. So this was not an editorial decision. It was a managerial administrative decision. This dictate was and still is very significant, especially in view of the subject matter being translation. To be sure, most of the newer journals in the field were even less open to non-English articles, which may be said to have turned a restriction to a merit of sorts. Target always had broader horizons than all the other periodicals that followed, and to a large extent imitated it. We were given a slightly freer hand in the review section, which has been an important component of Target from its very inception. The section was taken care of by Lieven Durst, who managed to recruit a growing number of reviewers, both young and new to the profession, as well as experienced scholars. Some of them are sitting in this room now. Stock of the reviews deserves to be taken separately because this pattern seems to be slightly different than the patterns that emerge from the articles and authors of the articles. Today I would mention one point which has important sociocultural roots as well as implications, namely to lament our failure to convince most of our reviewers to go beyond mere descriptivism and adopt a more critical stance. A similar position seems to have to be reflected in all other journals too. It seems to go together with being a relatively small and closely knit community where criticism is all too often interpreted as personal or at best sectorial. The restriction on languages has probably had no small impact on the growing marginalization in Target of research done in the German Sprachraum, and especially in France and other French-speaking territories such as Quebec. As is so well known, and in spite of some changes that have occurred, that have recently been occurring, these scholars still prefer to write and publish in their own languages. The same holds true for Italy or Japan, but not for most of the Spanish-speaking territories, especially Spain itself, which have been adopting English more and more as a language of academic communication. To be sure, as we shall soon see, Spain has become one of the main sources of manuscripts submitted for publication. It now occupies the first place alongside with China. A lot is bound to change in terms of accepted articles. This is articles submitted for publication. A lot is bound to change in terms of accepted articles once the active English of those scholars will have improved, because this is the main problem. In the seventh year of Target, Benjamin's made another administrative move which greatly influenced the format and contents of the journal. They decided to increase the number of pages per issue by over 50%, from 125 or 130 to 200 pages per issue. Among other things, it made it possible to publish longer and more elaborate studies. It also made it possible to bring a lot of raw or processed data in appendices in a variety of languages and alphabets. At the same time, it made life twice as difficult for the editor, who could do very little with his time except editing and proofreading. This is the main reason why I have published so little after 1995, another reason being my health condition, which you probably already had a hint to. As far as proper articles go, some 220 scholars representing almost 40 different countries have contributed to Target. 80% of them, 175 in number, supplied a single article each. Now I'm talking about articles that were published, not submitted for publication, which testified to openness and great variety. 32 scholars contributed two articles each, 8 scholars, 3 articles each, 2, 5 articles each, 1, 6 articles, and 2, 7 articles each. The three champions are Anthony Pym, Daniel Gilles, and José Lambert.
You're counting reviews?
No. Only articles. When I prepared it, I had several surprises, but this was not one of them. The number of scholars submitting manuscripts which were not accepted for publication is about 5 or 4 times that number, which testifies to a high degree of selectivity, not only with respect to other periodicals in translation studies. However, my concept of professional ethics hinders me from laying open the editor's waste paper basket. I have often played the game of trying to find out where the articles we rejected were finally published, but I will refrain from sharing the results of the game with you. It is not my intention to be critical towards others today, even by mere implication. Of course, the number of 40 countries constitutes a very small percentage of the entries that have attained independent geopolitical standing. For instance, less than 20% of the number of member states of the United Nations, which is now 192, at least it was last week. However, this number does represent a non-negligible portion of the academic world map, especially in the humanities and social sciences. This can be taken as a fulfillment of the aspiration to create a truly international journal, which was one of my main motives in drafting the 1981 document. This aspiration found its explicit expression in the subtitle of the journal. Until that time, scholarly articles on translation were scattered in a myriad of journals pertaining to a variety of different disciplines, normally a single article at a time. Theme issues devoted to translation started appearing rather late. Only very few periodicals were wholly devoted to translation, and the number of truly international ones among them was negligible. Meta and Babel readily come to mind, but that's more or less sums it up. You must all know the story about the poor man who drowned in a pond whose average depth was 20 centimeters. Under a similar observation, it could be claimed the Target had an average of 7.7 articles for each one of the countries that came on the list. However, while mathematically flawless, this number has precious little to say about the nature of the journal. Even less can it shed light on changes that may have occurred in the nature throughout the years. Thus, there is a very small number of countries whose accumulated contribution is rather dense. 221 articles, that is more than 75%, were contributed by the first 11 countries on the list. The first two of these 11 countries contributed over 10% of the production each. At the other end of the scale, 14 of the countries, altogether 4.7%, are represented by just one article each, almost as a kind of an accident, it would seem. There could easily have been other countries in that place. One clarification is due. I'm talking about the author's affiliation at the time of publication, which may well have been a foreign country for them. A single author may thus be listed under different countries at different points in his or her career, in accordance with his or her moves around the globe. One interesting feature in this respect is the existence of a rather weighty group of scholars who are affiliated with an institute out of their fatherland or even out of the country they had their academic training in. A German, a Dane, an Egyptian, a Greek, a Turk, or a Dutchman in the UK, an Australian and a number of Brits in Spain, a Swiss, an American, and a Dutch woman in Norway, and many more. To what extent is this phenomenon typical of translation studies in general? This correlation is certainly worthy of pursuing far beyond its manifestations in target. To be sure, implications may well go beyond the mere use of language. You know, talking about cultures.